So can PCOS affect my health in the long run? September is the PCOS awareness month. PCOS, it is the commonest endocrinopathy among women of reproductive age with prevalence of about 10%. It is crucial to diagnose PCOS early in its course. It is imperative not only to recognize it but also to delay or arrest its metabolic sequelae. Additionally, screening for the expected complications may allow for proper and timely management of these conditions. Although PCOS is associated with hyperandrogenism and infertility early in life, it is a harbinger of a lifelong condition that can lead to serious sequelae such as metabolic syndrome, diabetes mellitus, cardiovascular disease, dyslipidemia, endometrial hyperplasia or cancer, ovarian cancer, central obesity and sleep apnea. So what are the consequences of PCOS? There can be short term as well as long term complications. So this PCO, it causes hyperandrogenism and elevated insulin. This hyperandrogen will lead to hirsutism, acne, menstrual irregularity, infertility and obesity, and these all are the short term consequences of PCOS. Now on the other hand, this elevated level of insulin, this on one hand leads to hyperplasia or cancer, CVD, dyslipidemia and diabetes, and these are all the long term consequences of PCOS. So the various consequences, the age group at which the patient presents. At around 15 years, the clinical presentation will be of hyperandrogenism and oligoanovulation. Around 25 to 30 years, there might be infertility, hyperandrogenism, pregnancy complications. Around 45 years, again hyperandrogenism, glucose intolerance, and around 55 years, there will be cardiovascular events, type 2 diabetes, endometrial cancer. So for these problems, you need to refer to endocrinologist, diabetologist and a gynecologist, and for these problems you need to refer to cardiologist, diabetologist and a gynecologist. So what is this metabolic syndrome? The simple concept of metabolic syndrome is that it is a cluster of most dangerous risk factors for heart disease or heart attack, that is the diabetes or raised fasting plasma glucose plus abdominal obesity, high blood pressure, defective cholesterol metabolism. So metabolic syndrome, it is a combination of risk factors which includes insulin resistance and or high blood pressure, sugar, abdominal obesity, mainly the belly fat, elevated triglycerides or low HDL or high LDL cholesterol and hypertension. There is increased risk for diabetes, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, stroke, fatty liver disease and PCOS in young women. So what is the diagnostic criteria for this metabolic syndrome? When the female waist is more than 35 inches, triglycerides are more than 150 mg per deciliter, HDL is less than 50 mg per deciliter, blood pressure is more than 130 by 85 mm of Hg and fasting glucose is between 110 to 126 mg per deciliter and 2-hour glucose is more than 140 mg per cent. So the presence of 3 out of the 5 criteria confirms the diagnosis, and a insulin lowering agent and or other interventions may be warranted. So what are the risk factors being? Non-white race, sedentary lifestyle, BMI greater than 25, age over 40 years, cardiovascular disease, hypertension, hyperandrogenemia, insulin resistance, family history of type 2 diabetes mellitus, gestational diabetes, impaired glucose tolerance. So these are the risk factors. Now fundamental components of lifestyle management includes 3 basic components, that is the structured exercise, behavior modification and stress management strategies. So PCOS and type 2 diabetes mellitus. PCOS is a major risk factor for impaired glucose tolerance and type 2 diabetes. Obesity is the exacerbating factor. obesity predicts further type 2 diabetes. Screening for IGT or type 2 diabetes should be done by OGTT, and screening is important in hyperandrogenemia and anovulation, acanthosis nigricans, high BMI, family history of type 2 diabetes mellitus. So the recommended screening and diagnostic tests, glycosylated hemoglobin or HbA1c, fasting glucose and oral glucose tolerance test. Repeat screening every 3 years and if normal, annually if there is pre-diabetes. So what are the cardiovascular health risks? Cardiovascular health risks, PCOS patients have a 7-fold increased risk for a myocardial infarction. Several studies using intima media thickness as a surrogate for cardiovascular risk evaluation have shown potential increased cardiovascular risk in women with PCOS. PCOS patients have lowered HDL levels and increased LDL levels. Dyslipidemia. It is one of the most common metabolic disorders seen in PCOS. It is associated with insulin resistance and hyperandrogenism in combination with environment, that is diet and exercise and genetic factors. Decreased HDL, increased LDL and increased triglycerides. So its correlation with endometrial cancer. In chronic anovulatory patients with PCOS, persistently elevated estrogen levels, which are uninterrupted by progesterone, increase the risk of endometrial carcinoma. These endometrial cancers are usually well differentiated, stage 1 lesions with cure rate of more than 90%. So endometrial biopsy should be considered in PCOS patients because they may harbor these cancers as early as third decade of life. Abnormal bleeding, increasing weight and age are factors that should lower the threshold for endometrial sampling. Prevention of endometrial cancer is core in the management goal for patients with PCOS. Now, a few words on sleep apnea. Women diagnosed with PCOS should be asked about snoring, daytime fatigue, somnolence, informed of the possible risk of sleep apnea, and they should be offered investigation and treatment whenever necessary. Depression and mood disorders. The clinical features of PCOS such as infertility, acne, hirsutism and obesity, they promote psychological morbidity. When women with PCOS face challenges to their feminine identity, that can lead to loss of self-esteem, anxiety, poor body image and depression. The high prevalence of depression and other mood disorders in women with PCOS suggests that assessment and treatment of mental health disorders should be included in the evaluation and management plan. Lifestyle management improves quality of life and depression in obese and overweight and women with PCOS. So the psychological features. There is anxiety and depression, poor body image due to obesity, acanthosis nigricans, etc. The psychosexual dysfunction and eating disorders. They all lead to affect the quality of life. So what are the lifestyle modifications in PCOS? A consensus statement by the AEPCO Society. Overweight or obese PCOS women should initially attempt 5 to 10% weight loss. Non-pharmacologic measures are universally recommended. These measures include the following. The lifestyle measures, that is the diet, including seeing a dietitian who is knowledgeable in PCOS, exercise and weight reduction if the patient is obese or insulin resistant. So this is the pyramid showing the lifestyle modifications, the dietary, etc. So here is the patient should include colorful vegetables and fruits in the diet, then adequate amount of protein with grain and herbs, spices and healthy oils. So there should be a balance in between all these. So what are the guidelines for dietary and lifestyle intervention in PCOS? Lifestyle modification principles suggested for obesity management in polycystic ovarian syndrome. So, a lifestyle modification is the first form of therapy combining behavioral, reduction of psychosocial stressors, dietary and exercise management. Reduce energy diets, that is 500 to 1000 kilocalories per day reduction, are effective options for weight loss and can reduce body weight, by 7 to 10% over a period of 6 to 12 months. So dietary pattern should be nutritionally complete and appropriate for life stage, and should aim for less than 30% calories from fat, less than 10% calories from saturated fats, with increased consumption of fiber, whole grain breads, cereals and fruits and vegetables. Alternative dietary options, that is increasing dietary protein, reducing glycemic index, reducing carbohydrate, may be successful for achieving and sustaining a reduced weight, but more research is needed in PCOS. The structure and support within a weight management program is crucial and may be more important than the dietary composition. Individualization of the program, intensive follow-up and monitoring by a physician, and support from the physician, family, spouse and peers will improve retention. Structured exercise is an important component of a weight loss regime. You should aim for more than 30 minutes per day of the exercise. Structured exercise, they are planned, individualized and supervised. It includes aerobic exercise, resistance training that aims to reduce the glucose levels. So the summary, the polycystic ovarian syndrome, you all know it is associated with hyperandrogenism, acne, hirsutism, male pattern, hair loss, elevated serum androgens, associated with menstrual dysfunction in the form of oligomenorrhea or amenorrhea. So these are the polycystic ovaries which are diagnosed on ultrasound. Now associated with obesity and insulin resistance. So these are the dietary modifications. So overall, the treatment options include weight loss, oral contraceptives and spironolactone. So this was all about the PCOS. Thank you everyone for patient hearing.